So we shall start now on the next module of the course, that is on the joining processes. So this is also a big module about different processes which are used to join different products. So joining processes essentially are secondary processes. So what I mean by secondary processes is that to join any product, you first need to have that product. So often those products are realized from primary processes like casting or forming. So once you have the product with you, so joining processes can be used to realize a joint in those products. In the scope of this module, we'll be studying what are the different joining processes available and in when to use which process and some technical details of each of them. So I begin with the introduction to the term of joining. So joining is basically an all-inclusive term, or it is, I can say, a wider term which encompasses the terms like welding, brazing, soldering, adhesive joining, and mechanical fastening. So you might have heard about these terms at different places, like the joining using adhesives like Fevikwik, or mechanical fastening, for example, use of nuts and bolt. Then soldering is there. So soldering, even some of you might have even done it. And at some point of time, basically it is widely used to join or provide joint, especially in electronic components. Then, of course, there is welding and brazing, which you might have even seen being done at different places. So all these things, they come in this broad term known as joining. The objective is clear by the name, that the objective is intended to join two products. Now, the next important question that comes up is why it is required, or why joining processes are so important. So joining is basically required to assemble the components which are realized by other manufacturing routes. So often you will realize that the products that you use in daily life, so those products, they rarely are made in one piece. They have different components put into them which are functioning. And then basically different components are assembled together by some form or another form of a joining process. So another important aspect why joining is important is enlisted, that often the product, it is impossible to manufacture as a single piece. You may look around yourself and you will find it very difficult to identify a product which is functioning and it is made up in one piece. So there will be different sub components or sub assemblies which will be basically used to realize the complete product. And then second question comes, why we cannot make any product as a single piece. So this comes from the economical aspect of manufacturing, that for the sense of economical terms, the different parts are often more economic to be produced rather than the complete product being made in one part. And then the different sub-assemblies or sub-components are then basically clubbed together to have a more realistic working or functioning of the product. And the third reason that I have mentioned is basically there may be a situation where the different products of a or sub components of a given product may be disassembled, for example, for in maintenance. So just an example I can quote here, for example, the tires in a automobile. So if you want to change the tire because of some puncture, etc., so there are nuts and bolts which you can open up, and then you can remove the stepney and you can put the new tire. So you can understand that in several situations, the joint, it may be a permanent joint, or there may be a situation the joint is temporary. So depending on the need, the temporary joints, they may be opened and closed. So these are the basic reasons why it is important to study about joining processes. So I have just enlisted that there is a different terminology for permanent and temporary joints. So often what is realized in these four processes, they intend to give us permanent joints. Okay. And the mechanical fastening, most of them are temporary joints, or I can say they are semi-permanent joints using rivets. So semi-permanents are also there, so with the rivets, and purely temporary are using nuts and bolts. So I hope with this basic introduction, you are now ready to understand why joining is so important. And now we move ahead to other aspects of this. So last, but one point which was left was that often there may be a situation where parts which are made separately, they may be joined together because transportation of individual part is more economical. Here you can take the example of a wind turbine. So often you will see the wind turbine is basically a product which is used to make or used to generate renewable energy, or it harnesses the renewable energy by the wind flowing wind. So often this wind turbine, basically it has the assembly as there are blades. So generally three blades are there, and these are placed on a tower. So very often you will observe that these blades are so massive, say up to the blade size, it can be up to say 120 meters. So it is almost impossible to make the wind turbine in one of a single material and in one go. So often these blades are separately transported, the tower is separately transported, and then they are assembled at the site of installation. So a transportation is another aspect which we need to consider, and in that aspect the joining processes, they help a lot when the final product gets assembled at the site of installation. So as discussed earlier, the manufacturing processes are also classified as subtractive processes where the material is removed, or these are additive processes where the material is added, or there are zero processes where just the shape is changed, the material is not added. So as we discussed in the previous module, like forming processes, so forming processes basically intend to be a zero processes where you are not adding any material, but you are only changing the shape of the given material. But if we talk of joining processes, all these processes are additive processes because you are adding two parts, or the material is getting added to the product. So next, I'll show you some photographs of the actual joining processes being executed, like gas welding is there, where you have a gas flame which is used to join the products. Then you have adhesive joining, where you use an adhesive, for example, Fevikwik. So Fevikwik is a very domestic grade adhesive, and there are more industrial grade adhesives which can, retain their joining properties even at higher temperatures. Then there are fusion welding processes, like the arc welding processes, where the fusion is obtained by complete melting of the base materials. Then brazing is there. So brazing is essentially a process to join dissimilar materials with the help of a different material compared to the base composition. Then of course there are mechanical joints, as I have already discussed. These include use of fasteners like nuts and bolts and rivets. And lastly, soldering is there, which is widely used in the electronic joining applications. So these are some of the schematics, or if not schematics, photographs of the application of these joining processes. I can say virtually there is no aspect in our life which is aloof of the joining processes. Almost in every component you use or every product you use, there will be at least one joint. So it is so important that everywhere you will find that joining is there in some form or the another form. So just to summarize here, I have shown some representative applications, widespread applications of the joining processes, which include manufacturing of transportation like land in terms of car, bus, or etc. aircraft, and then even railways are there. Then all the ships which are moving around, then soldering is there, brazing is there. So you can understand it is a very, very important aspect toward realizing any product. Now we move ahead to the classification of the joining processes. So joining processes are essentially classified in welding, then adhesive joining, and mechanical fastening. So welding essentially includes again application of heat and pressure or pressure. So it is heat and pressure, or it is heat or pressure. So either ways it works. Then adhesive bonding, essentially it is basically using an external adhesive to basically join two parts. Example, I have already quoted as a Fevikwik being used in a domestic setup. And lastly is the mechanical fastening, in which basically we use fasteners like nuts, bolts, or rivets. So other methods beyond the rivets and these things are like seaming, crimping, and stitching. So this seaming, crimping, and stitching we will see in the subsequent slides in this module how these are being executed. But to just give you an overview about this, so all the corrugated boxes that you see, basically they are joined together to form a box. Essentially, it is a flat strip of corrugated cardboard, and then basically they are seamed or crimped together using some staples and all. So those come in the category of mechanical fastening. Then if I talk of welding, so welding is further classified in fusion welding, then brazing and soldering, and solid state. So fusion welding is essentially a process where heat and pressure, or heat or pressure, is applied basically to obtain coalescence of the underlying base materials, thereby inducing permanent joint between the two parts. And brazing and soldering are also permanent joining processes, but essentially the joint material is different than the base material. And in solid state welding, essentially there is no complete melting of the underlying base material takes place, but it happens in the semi-molten state. So if I talk of further classification of welding processes in under fusion, because fusion is a very popular welding process being used, they are further classified in terms of source of heat. So this basically here what we are talking of is source of heat. So for any welding process, basically there are two essential requirements. One is the application of heat, and then there may be application of pressure, but that is not in every case. But source of heat is definitely required. So in terms of fusion welding, the classification goes as chemical and electrical. And if we see some examples under the chemical-based processes, so they include oxy-fuel gas welding or thermite welding. Then in electrical-based processes where electrical energy is being used to generate heat, the processes that are included include arc welding, laser beam welding, beam welding. And if I talk of solid state welding, again, the two classifications are similar, like electrical and chemical. And lastly, there is a mechanical process which basically includes application of friction or friction stir welding or ultrasonic energy being applied to obtain the joints. So this is just a very basic, broad classification of various joining processes. Now we move ahead to discuss some more aspects on the welding processes. So welding, as already discussed, it is a subcategory under joining processes. So this is basically adding two materials. So this adding of materials, it can be taken place with the application of heat. So application of heat, it is foremost for any welding process. So this heat can be generated by various sources, as I already discussed. One could be chemical, electrical, then friction could be there, or there are some more. So with application of heat, you may join similar materials or dissimilar materials. So what I mean by similar materials, so you have one plate of, say, aluminium and one plate of, say, copper. So even these can be joined using the welding processes. And by similar, I mean both are say suppose of aluminium. So similar and dissimilar welding, what are possible with or without application of external pressure? Or there, the second requirement is the filler material. So filler material is also an optional. In some processes, the filler material is not added. So what is filler material? So filler material is the material which provides the metal in the gap, welding gap. And this has a melting point approximately similar to the melting point of the materials which are being welded. So based on the composition of the welds, so welds are categorized as heterogeneous welds, autogenous welds, and homogeneous welds. So heterogeneous, as the name itself is indicating, is heterogeneous means the filler composition is different than the parent material. So here parent material is intended towards the given plates or the workpiece which is to be welded. For example, in soldering and brazing, the filler material has a different composition than the parent material. In autogenous welds, basically we do not use any filler. For example, resistance welding or TIG welding is there. We'll see details in these more in the few slides, next few slides. Then homogeneous welds are there. The name itself, you can guess that the filler material has same composition as the parent material. So widely used in processes like arc welding, gas welding, and thermit welding. Now we'll see what are the different types of welding joints, because different products are made and the different products require a different configuration of a welded joint. So based on those configurations, we'll discuss some basic configuration of the welded joints. The first one is the butt joint, where essentially the two plates are being placed adjacent. Then we have a lap configuration where the two plates, they basically overlap each other to a certain extent. Corner joint is there, where you weld it at the corner somewhere here. Then a T joint is there, where you will provide the welded material here. And then there are edge joints. So these are some of the basic configurations of the different welding joints being used in different processes. Next are the positions of welding. So welding can be carried out in various positions, like flat position. This is a downward welding position. Then vertical position, where you weld vertically, means perpendicular to the axis or the surface or the ground. Horizontal is basically you're welding parallel to the surface of the or the ground. And overhead is basically when you are welding in the ceiling or which is on top of the over the head, means in ceiling or roof, those type of situations. So these are the different welding positions being used. Now we'll see different types of welds. So in terms of different types of welds, we have bead welds. So these basically the welds just are applied in the groove. They form this type of a bead. Then groove weld, where you have a groove instead of a gap. So those is known as a groove weld. Then fillet weld, these are used with lap configuration. And then is plug weld for this type of configuration in middle of a plate. Now just we'll discuss about the basic terminology in the welding joints. So welded joints, they have a specific terminology to indicate different aspects of the welded joint. So first one is the backing material. So backing material is essentially used to provide the support on the root side. So this is basically known as the face of the weld, means the top is known as the face of the weld and the bottom opening is known as the root of the weld. So backing plate is often used here at the root side, basically to control the penetration of the welded bead. Then base material, it is the name given to the material which has to be joined. So it has another name known as the parent material, which we have seen in the previous slide. So parent material, base material, all these indicate the same. Next is basically the bead or weld bead. So bead is basically the material which is added in a single pass. So welding may take place in different number of passes depending on the thickness of the plate. But the material deposited in, say, one pass is known as the bead. So this becomes the bead here. So next is basically the crater. So crater is basically a type of a depression being formed in the weld pool where the arc it strikes the base material. So at that point, a depression is formed, which is known as the crater. The deposition rate. So deposition rate is the rate at which the weld material can be deposited per unit time. So deposition rate basically indicates the productivity of the welding process. The productivity of the processes can be determined by this deposition rate. Higher is the deposition rate, means more material can be welded per hour. So this is normally expressed in kilograms per hour. So deposition rate of different processes is different. So based on the requirement, we can select the appropriate process depending on the how many products have to be made and what is the thickness of the plate which has to be welded. Next is basically the fillet weld. So fillet weld is basically a corner joint formed when the two pieces are approximately at 90 degrees. So this type of a weld which is formed here is basically known as the fillet weld. Puddle is the next term, which is a portion of the welded joint that is melted by the heat of the welding. And then root is basically, I already discussed, is basically the point where the two pieces meet are the nearest. So often this joint, this is not exactly a vertical joint, but this joint is prepared in a specific configuration or the groove is prepared. So at the bottom where the two plates are nearest, so that opening is known as the root or root opening, and the top becomes then the face of the weld. Next term is the tack weld. So tack weld is basically used to temporarily hold the two pieces together. So this may not be an actual weld, but to keep the two things to in place. So generally tacks are applied, which are temporary welds. So because in welding a lot of heat is applied, so there is often a situation of thermal distortion. So what may happen, the piece may get distorted or bent because of the heating cooling cycle during the welding. So distortion will basically disturb the geometry or the configuration of the pieces to be welded. So just to hold them in the given place, the tacks are applied, which are small temporary welds, which hold the pieces together instead of getting them far apart. So example here is suppose there is a very long plate. So if you don't put a tack weld, so what will happen? You start welding. So as the heat will flow, so there may be a situation the plate becomes slightly distorted. I am just exaggerating the distortion here. But to avoid this type of situation, what we will do, we will first initially provide a small welded joints at both the ends. So these small welded joints at both the ends, they become the tack welds. So which will hold the plates in together, and then the actual welding will be done in between. So actual welding will be done here in between. So this will basically hold the piece in the position of actual welding. Then toe of the weld is basically the junction at the weld face and the base material. So often this region is known as the toe of the weld. So now we look at the different ways through which we can generate heat, because that is the foremost requirement for doing any welding. Of course, nuclear fission is just one way, which is out of question, never used for welding. But all other methods being mentioned here, like combustion, can produce heat, where you is basically combustion, it is a process of burning flame is there. A flame is produced by basically combustion of a fuel gas and oxygen. So this is generally an exothermic reaction producing lot of heat. Then electrical arc is there, so where you have two electrodes and the gap in between the two electrode is ionized, so the plasma is formed, and this plasma it is at a very high temperature, which is sufficient to produce enough heat in order to fuse two materials and cause the welded joint to be formed. Then electrical resistance, of course, this is basically by passage of current. The heat is generated by the formula which you have already might have read in high school, I square RT. Then friction is there. So where friction is there, so there is a relative motion between two bodies, and the relative motion basically produces heat, and which is known as frictional heating. then explosion is there, where you have an explosive material which is an uncontrolled detonation or uncontrolled combustion, and this produces a shock wave, and that also leads to welding. So we have an explosive welding process in place, which helps or which is done with the help of these explosions. Then lasers are there. So laser is a very versatile tool. It is light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So it is a very versatile tool used for welding, cutting, and other things also. So essentially, this laser beam is a coherent beam of energy that impacts the surface. And by this impact of this high-intensity beam, the photons, they get they transfer their kinetic energy, and thereby just increasing the temperature of the workpiece. Of course, nuclear fission is another way, but it is not used in welding. So based on these methods, there are different welding processes. In the scope of this course, we will be discussing some of them, not all of them. But the processes which are being discussed are most relevant to the industry and being used to develop several products. So with the first, I begin with the fusion welding processes. So I will just cover only one of the process, some basics of one of the process today. So fusion welding processes are one of the widest used processes in welding. So this basically include a localized melting by using high density of heat energy. So localized melting means if there is, these are two plates here. So just at the joint surface, the melting will take place. We are not melting the complete plate. So only at the joint surface, the melting is taking place, and thereby the welding is accomplished. So heat source can be different in this cases. To produce fusion welding, heat source can be a gas flame, it can be an electrical arc, or it can be a high beam high energy beam like laser or electron beam. So the thermal energy which is required can be produced by chemical or electrical means. So chemical means will be combustion. So combustion is a chemical reaction or combination of a combustible material or a combustible media with oxygen that produces an heat, because it is an exothermic reaction. And then we have electrical means in terms of electrical arcs which are being produced. So energy density basically reduces from gas welding to arc welding to high beam. So if I plot it in a graphical manner, so energy density is like this. So if these are the heat sources here, and this is the energy density. So then what is the situation? So this is the gas welding, this is the arc welding, and this is the high energy beam. So this is how the energy density varies. So energy density plays a very important role in deciding the characteristics of the welded joint, its strength and performance. So generally, high energy beam processes, they are very expensive, but they produce a very high quality weld. And as the energy density reduces, the heat affected zone, it is a very important term in respect of welding, is also abbreviated as like this. So HAZ stands for heat affected zone. So heat affected zone is basically a zone near the welded joint, which is not actually the part of weld, but it gets influenced by the heat. So certain zone, I'll just show here. So this at a certain distance from the welded joint. So this is the joint. This is the bead. This is the base material. So this zone, a certain zone on both sides, is known as the heat affected zone. So generally, this HAZ, we want the HAZ to be minimal. So this heat affected zone, basically it is a zone which is affected by the heat of the welded welding process, which changes the microstructure of this zone, and thereby deteriorates the properties of the joint. Especially most of the welded joints, they often intend to fail or they break from this heat affected zone, rather than the welded joint. So as the energy density of the heat source, it reduces, the extent of heat affected zone, it increases. Because in low heat intensive processes, the heat, since the intensity is less, so the heat or delivery of heat takes a longer time. So this gives enough time to heat, for the heat to flow towards the base material. So thereby increasing the extent of heat affected zone. Where the energy density is quite high, so there the transfer of the required amount of heat is almost equal, or it is very short. So it does not give sufficient time for the heat to flow. So heat affected zone becomes small. So in the fusion welding processes, the filler materials are often added in the welded joint. So you add externally or maybe with the electrode, the filler material is added to this welded joint to create the joint zone. So I'll just quickly erase whatever I have explained to show you these photographs of different welding processes, which include arc welding, gas welding, and the example of laser welding, which is a high energy density beam. So this is the gas welding where you have a gas flame, and this is the filler material. So let me take, this is the filler. So here also, this is a arc welding process where basically an electrical arc is used as a heat source. And this is a laser welding process where you have this laser beam as the heat source. So with this, I'll just stop here, and we will take the discussion on the gas welding in the subsequent class. I can take quick questions from you if you have any.